The onset of change in a runaway boy. This is what I intend to call my reading corner. So I'll call it the Joshua Spencer reading corner. And today I just want to share a section of my book From New Mills to New Life with you. And I hope you'll enjoy it. So I'll be calling this, as I said, the Joshua Spencer Reading Corner. And I hope you'll enjoy. So today I'm going to share part of chapter 4 of one of my books, my autobiography, Fluctuating Life. And I was trying to do it a while ago using my laptop, but when I looked at it, it was terrible. The background and everything. So chapter 4 is entitled, or titled we say nowadays, The Onset of Change in a Runaway Boy. There were a few boys, girls and elderly people standing out on the King's Road. One boy seemed to have been playing marbles with a girl. I thought that was cool. I had not played marbles with girls before. I was so soft-hearted. I thought I was a better player than most girls, even though I was terrible as a player with my male friends. I did not want to crush them and then had to apologize every single game when they lose. I suddenly remember that my daddy, my mommy, and my mama had all told me that we should not judge a book by its cover, that everyone was equal. Boys and girls, and that my mommy in particular always said that God made us all, that he was an excellent God, and he would not have made some people inferior or superior to each other. She said that God gave each boy, each girl, each woman, each man a talent. Something that they are truly great at doing, but sometimes due to circumstances, mostly beyond their control, these people never discovered that they really possess these talents, these powers. I wondered why God would give you something and did not sit around to ensure that you make use of it. I said if I reach New Mill safely, the next time I play marbles, my first partners would be girls. I moved swiftly, trying not to be noticed. I did not want to have to answer any questions as to why I dressed so shabbily or why I was on the street without Uncle Ben. No one had ever seen me without my family being there. Everyone by now knew me and that I was related to the King's School principal. Some even rumored that I was the son of the principal with another woman. At the intersection of the King's Road and the White House Road, I made a right, just like Uncle Ben had done with us in the car numerous times. I then continued straight. The street lights were shining in all their glory. I was concerned that it was going to be extremely difficult to pass through the White House Square undetected. A sudden sadness and fear wrapped, blanketed, and unnerved me instantly. I wondered what was the chance of me turning back, and Uncle Ben either forgave me, had pity on me, or said, after all, I was his best brother's kid, that I was a poor dead left and still a child. Everyone is entitled to one chance, I imagined him thinking. I looked back and then remembered how angry he got while he caned John. Every time the cane strike did not make contact with some body part of John, Uncle Ben seemed to have gotten even angrier and seemed to have doubled the number of canings for everyone that he missed. the thought encouraged me to take the risk and to walk somewhat bravely toward and into the square. There was a stream of parked cars on either side of the road. There was loud music and chatter. A young man with an older looking woman seemed to have been in embrace. I wondered whether they were parent and son or lovers. I walked closely to the cars and stepped with confidence through the square. I had an urge both to run and look back, but I resisted the impetus. I did not want to bring attention to myself. The sun had started to set. I remembered my friend in Berkshire and his obsession with sunset. To be fair, Harry did not have an obsession with sunset. His parents did. He was only following orders. I wondered about him for a while, and Mama, Mr. Lovell, and my sister, Georgia, and my other siblings who had been born while I lived at New Mills. I was thinking whether Mama had heard that my dad had passed. It dawned on me that I did not write her. I felt ashamed. I comforted myself by saying that I was too busy with housework at Uncle Ben's to have engaged in writing. I thought probably Mama, Pa, Aunt Grenda, or Uncle Ben should have ensured that my mother was informed. I said that was exactly the problem. Everyone was thinking that the other would have informed my mother. I wondered what else in life our country was not getting done, because it sat patiently, hoping that someone else would do it. I often heard the PNP and the JLP, the Jamaica Labour Party, supporters, even the ministers and the members of parliament, blaming each other that the PNP or the JLP when in power did not do this or that thing, and that the PNP or the JLP when in power did not do this thing or that thing or the other. I now understood why this happened. Sorry. The road grew darker and the number of vehicles passing had been reduced to a trickle. Like the water in the pipes, we had to travel 2 miles or so to from New Mills during drought. I was not sure whether I should have been happy or sad about that situation with the vehicles. I had a dual, uncertain feel about the whole thing. When the cars passed, I felt somewhat afraid that someone might have been in the car and recognized me. If that was the case, they would stop and ask a whole courthouse of questions, I thought. Also worried that there could be the takeaway men in the car. As a younger boy at New Mills, the boys told me about the takeaway men, that they would stop their car and ask for directions. I give you candies, sweeties. Then they would grab you and take you away in the car. Then I thought, why would the takeaway men take you away? What would they do with us? Is it that they were lonely and wanted a big family? Would they cook us and eat us like Pa would munch his roasted pigs? If not any of the above, why then? Were they so rich that they had to have some extra mouths to feed? On the other hand, I felt like I had company when the cars were constantly passing me on the now lonely thoroughfare. My thoughts subsided suddenly when I realized that it was really getting late and dark. I imagined that it was about 7:30 to 8:30 p.m. or later. The sun sometimes set so early, and then a whole flood of darkness would appear upon the earth like thieves about to rob a bank. I started to think about ghosts and my dad. I wondered whether he was tiptoeing behind me all along. I wondered whether he had seen what his favorite brother had attempted to do, or what he had been doing to me since they took me into their house last summer. Sorry. I suddenly recalled a few days after moving to the King School cottage that while I was washing dishes on the back veranda late one Saturday night, I saw what appeared to have been two legs walking up the steps, wearing a similar pair of gray pants and an upper body, no head, wearing a white shirt similar to the one that he wore to meet me at Charles Square in Montego Bay. I had run inside to tell my Uncle Ben. My uncle retorted that I was talking foolishness and that my mommy had taught me foolishness about ghosts. Later that same night, I recalled her hearing some rubbing against my bedroom walls and saw a bright light being shone through my window. I ran out and advised Uncle Ben. Again, he said that it was stupid to think of ghosts. However, about 5 minutes later, he came back to my room and was asking me a whole bunch of questions. I figured that whatever had come rubbing on the walls of my bedroom and lighting up my room must have done the same thing with his on the other side of the house. The thought got me scared. It was now pitch dark. I arrived at the Ferris Square. The streets formed a fork. One could either keep left and end up in the capital town of Savalalma, or keep right and go toward Withorn to Darlaston to New Mills. I stopped and tried to figure out which one would be the best route to travel. The direct route through Withorn to Darlaston to New Mills would have been shorter, I thought. Uncle Ben had traveled both routes in the past, depending on his mood. The Savalalma route was longer, but there were brighter lights, better roads, and there would have been people. Furthermore, the direct Withorn to Darlaston to New Mills route was quite hilly, bushy, and tiring. The thought of making a decision overwhelmed me. Suddenly, I saw two persons who appeared to be workers at the Ferris gas station. I walked over to them. I told them that my dad wanted to beat me up for no reasons, and that I was on my way to my grandma's place in New Mills. That I was afraid because it was getting late. I did not want to explain anything about my father having died and that I was living with my uncle. To my surprise, the guy said I could stay there overnight. I was so happy. They spread clothes on the floor inside the building at the back, and we all slept there until early dawn. The next morning, I resumed my journey, settling on traveling the direct route to Withorn, to Darlaston, to New Mills route. When I thought about it now that I was rested, the route would have ended with me going to Withorn, to Darlaston, to New Mills, unless I was going to walk to Chester Castle, walk up Galloway, through Bethel Town, past the entrance to the district of Castle Mountain, to New Mills. I walked and ran as much as I could. As I began to climb the steep hill to ascend into my mommy's home and bosom, I heard the roar of a motor vehicle coming up the rugged hill. I started to run. I was growing breathless, but I had to keep going. I ran past the breadfruit tree of which I sat when I heard of my father's death, and headed for under the house. My mommy had spot me, and had also heard the engine of Uncle Ben's car. I placed my finger on my lips, indicating to my mommy that she should not say anything. I knew I could count on her. I went up to the far corner under the bottom of the house. There was a black hen that was sitting on what seemed to be more than a dozen eggs. She got a little annoyed upon my uninvited arrival. I quickly slid to the other side, a little distance from the hen, just in time for the hen to keep quiet, and my Uncle Ben to make giant steps into our yard, calling, "Mommy? Ben, what happened? What happened? Why are you here so early, Ben?" Mommy queried. I knew my mommy had some genuine concerns. She had seen me go under the house, but she did not know why I had to go under the house. Could I have been involved in a fight? Could her precious Ricky have stolen something from someone at King's or White House, bringing shame to Uncle Ben and his family? Worse, could I have unconventionally struck a boy and he died? Mommy just did not know. So it was not that she was pretending to have been worried or concerned. She was indeed genuinely worried and concerned after seeing me. She must have been dying in her heart that she did not get the opportunity to find out what had really happened firsthand from me. Mommy's black cat joined the hen, the eggs, and I under the house. At first, she seemed a little startled to see me by her usual resting place, but unlike the black hen, she did not protest. I placed my fingers at my lips, the same signal I gave my mommy, and the cat seemed to have understood perfectly well. It came over and rubbed against me slightly. I felt so great for a brief while. Since I left New Mills, I didn't have much physical expression of love from any family member. No cats, no dogs, not even the rats I heard in the ceiling of the King School cottage had any respect, much more to show me love. Certainly no slight rubbing against my body or embrace from anyone. The cat made me feel that I was still appreciated, that I still had family. "That idiot you have as grandson ran away last night," he uttered. "What do you mean, idiot? How could you be calling your own flesh and blood idiot? What has been coming over you, Grandma asked. "Ever since you married that woman, I noticed the big change in you. It is as if she has you in a trance," she continued. "Mommy, I am sorry, but the stupid boy will get me in trouble. He walked out of the house and nobody knows where he is," Uncle Ben said. "I can't stay much longer," Uncle Ben continued. "Who knows if something has not already happened to him since he left?" "When did he leave?" my grandma asked. I got concerned that Mommy would let Uncle Ben know that I was under the house. I said to myself, let's face it, Uncle Ben is her son. I'm merely a grandson. According to all those questions Aunt Avona was asking me the other day, there was a big chance that we weren't even related. She was not going to let her son go through so much agony and concern while she knew I was under the house with her cat and hen, I thought. I waited nervously for Mommy to disclose my little but safe haven. "Ben, have you been treating that boy well?" she questioned. "I've been dreaming of Johnny ever since you took his son over to your place. Believe me, he seems angry all the time. Something is not right, Ben." "Listen to me, Ben. Are you treating your own blood and flesh right? Ricky is your nephew, your own flesh and blood," she remarked. I heard steps receding from the house. I heard some murmuring in the distance. I assumed it was Uncle Ben leaving to report my being missing at the Betheltown police station. I wondered what was the reason he was going to tell them that I left the comfort of his posh government school cottage for the street or wherever he thought I was. I thought that the cops might have become suspicious of him if I was not found, that I might have been considered dead like Dad. They would now have two unsolved cases of two closely related persons on their hands, whose cases were still unsolved. The last after a full year had elapsed. They might have even considered my uncle suspecting my going missing. I wondered how that would have affected him, being a principal or even a Third Sunday priest. He might have also been considered suspect for his brother's death in that case as well. The thought made me feel sad. I was proud that I had an uncle who was a principal, even though I was ashamed of the way he treated me. I quickly remembered what Daddy had told me about cops some time ago, that you could get out of trouble with them if you did something wrong by bribing them. I now knew what to bribe the cops meant, but at the time my dad told me I was quite unaware of them, of the term bribing. For a moment I had a sigh of relief to to know that after all, my Uncle Ben, principal, would probably not have lost his job if I were to remain quiet in hiding. Upon further analysis, it made me feel rotten. How many of our police officers were involved in bribery, I question. Can those cops not involved in bribery arrest those colleagues and throw them into jail for giving the Jamaica police force a bad name, I thought. Mommy came to the side of the house where the black hen still sat. The black hen was quite a protective fowl. As long as I was under the house, the black hen would never go for a break from her eggs. If only some parents and families were as protective, loving and caring as the black hen, I thought. What if they could just show a little tender care to someone like me without a father, even an active mother? Would there not be less pain in the world? I thought. Mommy finally got on her bony knees and peeped up under the house. She laughed that she did not realize that I had moved away from the side I entered and where all along she thought I was lying listening to her. She wondered why I moved away from what she thought was a safe hiding spot. I explained that the hen would not allow me to sit on the side of the house and how loving the cat was. Mommy said that Peck was like that when she was preparing to hatch her chickens. She said she knew that something was up with her because when she was feeding the other hens, she scarcely ever came to feed, and normally Peck loved corn very much. When she planted corn around the house, Peck would scratch out all 5 grains from each hole and leave only the peas. But when she was preparing to hatch her chickens, she was a different hen. I thought my mommy would have said she was a different person, because that was exactly how Peck behaved, like she was a person, a very responsible and great person, not a hen. I told my mommy what had taken place at King's Aldgate School, the school of which Uncle Ben was principal. I told her that I did not want to return and that she, or Aunt Grenda, could go to fetch my clothes. The next day, my mommy and I walked to the Bethelton police station to let them know that I was safe. They wanted to know why I left, but mommy interrupted by saying that I had just about a year ago lost my dad. I held onto my mommy's hand while she made her tiny steps toward the long journey in the direction of her home in New Mills. So that's Joshua Spencer's Reading Corner for today, guys. Hope you enjoyed. It's From New Mills to New Life by yours truly, Joshua Spencer. Is available all over the place. Barnes & Noble, Amazon.com, Amazon.ca, Amazon UK, and all the other places. And as I always say, if you go to the various bookstores, whether in the Caribbean or in North America, and you don't see it, you can ask for it. And the more you ask for the book, the more likely it will be ordered. Thank you guys for listening. I hope this one was, I'll be sharing more and more in my Reading Corner. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope it got you curious. Thank you very much, and have a great day. Bye for now. Bye-bye.